The Pennsylvania German Hour is underwritten by the Pennsylvanische Deutschversammlung von Bodecks County, the state's largest annual Pennsylvania Dutch language gathering, traditionally held the first Monday after Easter in the Leesport Auction Hall. The Pennsylvania German Hour is also brought to you by the West Berks Versammlung, held annually on the first Saturday in October. The Pennsylvania German Hour is also brought to you by the Rentschler Leib family and Reverend Richard Miller and family. The Pennsylvania German Hour is a production of the Nye Dolpahock Sanger Corps, the regional Pennsylvania German choir specializing in traditional and contemporary dialect music for the heritage language community. The Pennsylvania German Hour is produced in cooperation with the Pennsylvania German Cultural Heritage Center at Kutztown University, the hub of Pennsylvania Dutch language and culture. Contact us at 610-683-1589 or visit us online at www.kutztown.edu/pgchc. Mir zauwe groß Dank zu alle unser Gucke, Unterstützer und Freund. Gute Maria, liebe Gucke, und willkommen zum Pennsylvanisch Deutschstund, der Beschblatt für Deutschzuhörer auf BCTV. Heute ist der Svet Hanning 2024 und Grunzau Dog ist endlich da. Mavella hoffe, dass der Grunzau hat etwas Gutes zu sagen heit, wehe was es Wetter gibt, es Frühjahr oder ein langer Winter. Im Geist vom Grunzau Dog gebe mir ein gutes Interview mit dem Dr. William W. Donner von Kutztown University, wehe sei Research auf der Grunzau Latsche in Pennsylvanisch Deutsch Kultur. Und dennoch, ein gleich Präsentation wäre unser alte deutsche Wetterweisheit, der Grunzau und der alte Bauerkalender vom Jahre zurück. Today I would like to welcome Dr. Bill Donner from Kutztown University for an interview that we're going to conduct in English. Dr. Bill Donner is the department chair for the Anthropology and Sociology Department at Kutztown University, but among the Pennsylvania Dutch, he is widely known for being the MC at the Kutztown Folk Festival seminar stage. He has written a book called Serious Nonsense about the Groundhog Lodge movement, and most people don't know about Bill is that he spent a lot of time in the Solomon Islands and has extensive experience doing field work as an anthropologist. So let's welcome Bill today with us here on BCTV. Thanks so much for coming out, Bill.
Oh, it's a pleasure. It's a real pleasure to be here. I'm happy to be here. I'm an anthropologist, and my first field research was in the Solomon Islands on a little island called Sikaiana. And I did what an anthropologist did. I lived there for about 3.5 years, and the people, there was a boat once a month. The people lived mainly by gardening and fishing. And I always tell people that if you're not with the one you love, love the one you're with. And that's how I got interested in Pennsylvania Germans coming to Kutztown University. So I have some Pennsylvania German ancestors. I was brought up, my mother was always talking about her grandfather who took her back to Wummelsdorf. So that was my ancestral connection. But as I tell in my book, growing up in Philadelphia, I had very little to do with Pennsylvania Germans. And when I got a job here, and I thought I was lucky as an anthropologist to have a job, when I got a job at Kutztown University, I thought, well, I really should learn about these people that inhabited this area and that were actually ancestral to me. So that's my story of how I got interested in the Pennsylvania Germans.
Well, we're really glad that you're with us and that we're able to benefit from all the good work that you do at the university and the Kutztown Folk Festival. Tell us a little bit about what you do at the festival and also the university.
Okay. Well, at the university, I should mention, I'm the coordinator of the Pennsylvania German Studies minor. And we do have a Pennsylvania German Studies minor. And one of our more notable graduates is Patrick Donmoyer, who, were you in that class 10 years ago?
It's been about 10 years.
And Alice Spade, who was in the last group, took that class as well. So we have a Intro to Pennsylvania German Studies class, and then we do have a minor. We don't have any students, but I think they're all highly motivated. Many of them work with Patrick down at the Heritage Center, and we're proud of that program. On the seminar stage, I'm the manager, but actually it's really the talent that comes there that makes the stage work. And we have different events throughout the week. Now the festival, those of you who don't know, it's a 9-day festival. We have some people who come every day, give talks on the seminar stage, and then we have some special events. And I think for your audience, I should mention the Liars Contest.
Yes.
We haven't set a date, but usually we have 2 days of people coming and telling lies in Pennsylvanisch Deutsch. And then we asked them to follow it with English. This is something that was done in this area in the 1940s and 50s, kind of fell out of favor by the 60s and 70s, and then we tried to bring it back about 10 or 12 years ago at the seminar stage. And then we also have a writers' festival. That was actually an idea of Ed Quinner. They have these regional dialect writing festivals in Europe, especially Germany and France and Belgium, where regional dialects of French or German are still preserved and people bring stories. And Patrick, actually, he's a liar. You know, don't believe everything he says. He's in the liars contest, but he also participates in our writing festival. So that's another important event. If any of you have anything you'd like to present on the stage, you can, if you're on email, Donner, like the reindeer, donner@kutztown.edu, or you can contact me through Patrick at the Heritage Center, or you can contact me through the Anthropology Department at Kutztown University, Kutztown 19530. So those are the things going on. Now, special events, we have Harry Serio talking about the Reformation and the religious origins of the Pennsylvania German. Mary Laub comes on a couple days and talks about the clothing and the teaching of the Old Order Mennonites who are in our area. And then we have a very distinguished and interesting speaker, Patrick Donmoyer, who talks about the research he's done on powwowing and on hex signs. So we have a very good lineup. We also have some Pennsylvania Dutch events. We have oftentimes Leroy Brown and Bill Meck going back and forth. One will speak in Dutch and then the other will speak in English. So those are some of the events. And you may know more about the German consulates are going to be on the stage there.
We are going to have a visit from the Consul General, David Gill, from New York City, from the German consulate. And we're going to have him on both Saturday and Sunday, the first 2 days of the festival. We're in the midst of coordinating details about that, but it'll be a talk about German-American friendship and relations between the two countries. And it's very exciting to be hosting David Gill once again.
Okay. One more thing I should mention, if you get bored on the seminar stage, don't be shy, just leave, and right across the runway is Patrick painting hex signs, and he usually has a really good exhibit, too, of different aspects of Pennsylvania German culture that the Heritage Center puts up. So come see us on the seminar stage, and when you get tired of us, just walk across the street, and you'll see Patrick.
Wonderful. Well, it's always a pleasure working with you at the festival, Bill. Now, let's talk a little bit about your book. Your book on the Groundhog Lodges, Serious Nonsense. We have an image of this we can put up on the screen.
Oh, okay, yeah.
This was groundbreaking in many respects because no one had really given any form of serious scholarly attention to this really important cultural movement in this area. Yeah. Tell us a little bit about the work that you've been doing and the role that the lodges play in preserving the local culture.
Okay, well, about, I guess it must have been 15 or 20 years ago, your predecessor at the Heritage Center, David Valeska, sent me to a Groundhog Lodge meeting. And I was absolutely enthralled with an event in which everybody speaks only in Pennsylvania Dutch, and not so much now, but in the old days you'd get fined for each word of English that you use. And as you saw, there's a 8-foot groundhog, which used to be wheeled into the meeting, so you can see the picture there. But now stands up at the front of the meetings. And a lot of ceremony associated with the groundhog and his legendary ability to predict the future. And I just became enthralled with the fact that you had, you can see these grown men and Pennsylvania Germans who, you know, in my prejudiced Philadelphia background, I always thought it was kind of stodgy and quiet and conservative, getting very excited about the groundhog. And so I got very interested in this event, and I started doing some research on it. I started talking to a lot of the people. Just a couple main points I'd like to make about it. One thing I feel about Pennsylvania Germans, you talk about the tradition, one thing I've learned about Pennsylvania Germans is they're never the same. They've changed over time. And if you looked at 1750, it's not clear we could talk about Pennsylvania Germans or Dutch at that point, but certainly by 1800, you were seeing the formation of a culture and a language. They were one thing. If you looked in 1850, you'd see something else. 1900, something else. 1950, something else. The lodges are part of something new. They're not something that went on in Germany. They're something that came here in America. And one of the themes I develop here is Pennsylvania Germans are really an American culture. They derive from Europe. But the things they do now and the things they did even by 1800 were things they did here in America. And our colleague Mark Loudon has written a book, Pennsylvania Dutch, The Story of an American Language.
Yes.
Pennsylvania Dutch itself
is
really an American event. So 1934 was the first lodge gathering. This was something that I don't know where it all came from. A lot of the ceremony seems to be borrowed from the Masonic lodges, but it's something the Pennsylvania Germans put together on their own. They created this event. And one of my points is it started in 1934 as something new. By the 1960s, it was tradition. And I think today, people look at it as a tradition. And all traditions start somewhere. This one started by Pennsylvania Germans who wanted to express their heritage in 1934. I'd say, you know, as you know, it's eroding a little bit because we don't have many, we're losing a lot of the older speakers of the Pennsylvania Dutch language. But for 80 years, it's been a pretty strong movement. It started with one lodge. Eventually, there were actually over 18. There were 18 officially recognized ones. And then the facsimiling that you talked about, the gatherings. Mm-hmm. Groundhog lodges, I'm sorry, only males traditionally, though they're talking about including females now. And then the facsimilings are both males and females. The idea for the oldest one, the Berks County one, which is coming up after Easter, the idea for that actually came from some men who were driving away from the first Groundhog Lodge meeting. Well, the lodge number one, it was actually the third or fourth meeting that they were holding, and they said, well, really, women should be participating in this. And they founded the Berks County for someone. So I talk about all this in the book.
That's wonderful. Now, another central figure in the work that you've been doing, you've been looking at Clarence Ron. And Clarence Ron was featured in a recent book through the Heritage Center, Dovilik Ava, The Radio Adventures of Asabe and Sabina, because he was the writer of that famous show.
Yeah.
There were translations that were recently done by Greg Hansen at the university. And you assisted with the creation of an exhibition to honor Clarence Ron. Can you tell us a little bit about who he was and what his impact was for the culture?
Yeah, Clarence Ron was a German Reformed minister. The German Reformed Church joined up with the New England Congregationalists, and now is now the United Church of Christ. When I was doing research about the Groundhog Lodges, one of the things I found is they always have a talk, the Festrad. Mm-hmm. And what people told me is the talk should involve humor, but also there should be a serious content to it. And I was thinking when you were talking about the proverb that you gave about people, mm-hmm. that's the kind of theme that you'll see humorously presented at a Festrad. And everybody said the best speaker was a man named Clarence Ron. And Don Breininger, who is a very well-known speaker, he said, actually, Ron was the minister for his wife's family, that he's a very popular speaker. He said he learned from Clarence Ron. And so I started doing research about this person who was a really a great speaker. What I found was Ron was, to me, and you know, you actually are the expert about Pennsylvania Germans in my opinion, but what I found was Pennsylvania Germans oftentimes value a kind of earthy, Renaissance kind of person who's done everything. And Ron had, you know, done manual labor, he'd been a teacher, he'd been done lots of different things before he became a minister, and he used this wealth of experience as a way to express himself, both as a minister who was very, very popular, and then also he became a very popular speaker at the Groundhog Lodges and the Facsimiling. Now, the book you're talking about is Asabe and Sabina. Between, was it 1944 and 1954, 55, mm-hmm. he wrote radio plays in Pennsylvania Dutch. And these were broadcast in Allentown. And there were about a farm couple, Asabe and Sabina. And I think they give, these the whole play was in Pennsylvania Dutch, but I think they give real insight into what Pennsylvania German farm life was like, but also with a lot of humor. And Greg Hansen, our colleague at in the German department at Kutztown University, has translated a book of these transcripts, and the Heritage Center published that book. And as part of that, I thought it'd be nice to have an exhibit about Clarence Ron, about Asabe and Sabina, the radio plays, and also about Ron himself. And I've been very fortunate that his daughter, Ruth Schaefer, has been very helpful in my research and helping me find out a lot about her father and what he did. And her husband, until he passed away, Richard, was also another Lutheran minister, but
knew, of course, Clarence very well and was very helpful. So, you know, I'm really impressed with Ron as your kind of Pennsylvania Dutch everyman. He was compared in local newspapers to Mark Twain and Will Rogers. Your audience, I don't know if they know back then, but Will Rogers in the 1920s and 30s was the most popular radio person, a kind of down-home humor. Ron didn't like the comparison with Mark Twain because Mark Twain was an atheist and Ron was religious, but it was kind of this humorous way of looking at everyday life. It's something I think important in the Groundhog Lodges, and also Ron was a great proponent, great person to express that. And I think that book, Asabe and Sabina, which will be on sale at Heritage Center April 4th, I think that's a great example of Ron's humor.
Now, we have two images of Ron as well to put up on the screen. One of Ron speaking at the Groundhog Lodge, where you can see him kind of in the background there at the podium, but in the front is a coffin that is announcing the death of the tradition surrounding the goose barn.
Yeah.
Can you just briefly describe what's going on in that picture?
Well, there's a lot of humorous, I guess, competition between the groundhog, the Pennsylvania Dutch groundhog, and other ways of predicting the future. And in Allentown, there was somebody who could read goose bones and say he could tell what the weather would be. And so there's competition between the goose and between the groundhog. And a lot of humor in these lodges. What they've done is they've buried the goose bones because a false prophet, I guess in today's terms, fake news coming out of the goose bones about what the weather's going to be like. The groundhog is the best predictor. And so this is humor. There's oftentimes there's competition with Punxsutawney Phil, of course, the famous one. And the people in the Pennsylvania Dutch groundhogs will tell you Punxsutawney Phil is a liar, never gets the weather right. The problem is that the real weather prophet speaks in Pennsylvania Dutch. And so you have to be Pennsylvania Dutch to know whether spring's coming soon or not. That was actually the New York Times. Back in the 1960s, wrote an editorial about how stupid all this groundhog stuff was. And the Allentown Morning Call replied, well, you're just a bunch of dumb New Yorkers, and you don't speak Dutch, so you don't know how smart a groundhog is.
And I wrote an editorial a couple years back about why I thought the local groundhogs, because they spoke Dutch, were better than Punxsutawney Phil, and their retort was that he speaks groundhoggese.
Oh, that was from Punxsutawney.
Yes. Oh, okay. I don't think they like my observation.
Right, there's so always competition.
We have time for maybe one more question here, and I guess my thoughts are, as an anthropologist, how do you feel about what it means to be part of the Pennsylvania German culture and how it's changing? This is kind of a
question,
but this was one of the ones we talked about. I know you mentioned a little bit about the idea that the identity is always changing, that from one generation to the next.
Well, what they do and the identity, but the society's changing, and, you know, as you know, I think you have to separate out, to me, the Anabaptists, especially the Old Order people, who preserve a way of life that's religiously based from what I call a secular Pennsylvania German identity, mm-hmm. which we usually associate with the church people, the German Reformed and Lutheran people. Now, tell your audience, he's actually the expert on this, so he could maybe next time he can give you an answer. I'm the anthropologist, yeah. I think it's so hard to say what's happening. One thing clear about the Pennsylvania Germans as a European migrating ethnic group, they preserved their culture, their language, longer than any other European migrating group, longer than Italians, longer than German Americans who came later when Germany was starting to form as a nation, longer than the Irish, longer than any other group. They preserved a language and a distinctive culture. And that really, to me, makes them very exciting and interesting. I would say they were a unique people who spoke a distinct language, certainly into the 50s. If you'd gone to Kutztown in the 1950s, you would have heard Pennsylvania Dutch on all the street corners. These would not have been these horse and buggy Old Order Mennonites who hadn't even moved up there until 1949. But these were these much more liberal car-driving, tractor-driving Pennsylvania Germans. So we can say that. What's happened you know, more recently, a lot of people say if you don't speak the language, you're not part of the culture. Especially the older people know the language, that would really limit, you know, who could be considered Pennsylvania Germans. But my view is culture is always changing. Pennsylvania Germans were not the same in 1900, they were in 1950, not the same in 1950, 2000. And one of the things is the Tolpachan Choir, the Groundhog Lodges, your work at the Heritage Center, that's a present-day expression of Pennsylvania German culture. Now, technically, the social scientists call this ceremonial culture. They say, you know, the Italians get out on Columbus Day, the Irish get out on St. Patrick's Day, they've lost their culture. Pennsylvania Germans aren't quite that far along, but, you know, you could look at these events as ceremonial. But this Groundhog Lodge was ceremonial in 1934, and it's traditional today. It's a way to preserve the culture. I think, you know, is the glass half full or is it half empty? And you're a younger guy, you'll be able to tell us in the future what, whether it was half empty or half full.
Well, I appreciate it. You know, the one thing I hope that some anthropologists can tell us in the future is how we can talk about our culture with the Pennsylvania Dutch. We've got the what used to be the church people and the sectarians. We don't have a positive term right now for the descendants of the church people. We can say those people used to be called the church people, but I think we need to come up with some way to positively describe that secular experience, which church people and secular actually seems like a contradiction, but we're really talking about the broader culture.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you, I don't want to end on a term I hate, but sometimes there are 90%, 95% of the people who are Pennsylvania German back in the 18 and 1900s are these church people. Sometimes they're referred to as non-sectarian, and I hate that term because you're talking about the majority by what they're not. So the sectarians being, of course, the old order people who stand out so much.
Well, thank you so much for coming out today.
It was a
Bill,
pleasure
having this conversation. It's always wonderful to have you with us, and we appreciate all that you're doing for the culture, both at the festival and at the university and among the lodges. So thanks so much.
My best student.
Thank you, Bill. All right, and that's all we have for you today.
Willkommen zurück zum Pennsylvanisch Deutschstund, the best blots for Deutsch zu hören auf BCTV. Today, in the spirit of Groundhog Day, I want to offer a short presentation on weather prognostication traditions among the Pennsylvania Dutch. These are diverse traditions that have been accumulated over the years in a variety of different circumstances, both agricultural, domestic, and religious, and they overlap through all spheres of life. Even if you don't have any faith in what the groundhog has to say, perhaps some of these different traditions might at least give you a glimpse of the way in which the culture has viewed weather as being subjective to a wide variety of different forces that were perceived to govern the way that the cosmos ran. So my hope is to be able to share some of those things with you today and give you an idea of how some previous generations viewed the weather. Pennsylvania Dutch weather prognostic traditions are things that at one point in time suffused all aspects of life. These were traditions that you would find in the home, on the farm, and especially associated with the almanac that was so common on the farm. The almanac, of course, was also influenced by the church calendar of the year, so you're going to see a cross-pollination of both religious ideas as well as those ideas that are from the secular sphere of things. And the interesting thing about this is, generally speaking, you can find that these weather prediction techniques fall into three basic categories of observation. Those that are using the church calendar as it was viewed through the almanac traditions, those which observed the animal kingdom, and those which observed the vegetable kingdom. Of course, the natural world was perceived to be put into place and ordered according to divine rules, and so therefore, the belief was that one could sense an idea of how the future might pan out based upon observing other members of the kingdom. And so this idea is, of course, partially a sacred idea. The notion that all things were created and part of a sacred universe undergirded these ideas. So this is partially why we'll find that the groundhog was perceived to have certain powers, and certain plants were also thought to portend
different aspects of life. The other side of this is that over time, humans have come to understand that animals and also plants are thought to be more sensitive than human beings when it comes to the changes in the climate, changes in the weather, and of course, seasonal shifts. And so this sort of thing has been popular for many generations. If we take a look especially at the animals, many folks have heard of the idea that the cows lie down when it's going to rain, and perhaps you've seen this. You may have also seen the cows lying down on some of the hottest summer days. So these types of things are not 100% reliable, but these, of course, are things that have been gathered over the years. And many of these types of phrases were succinct, they would rhyme, and they were often memorized in Pennsylvania Dutch language. You're going to find everything from the idea of roosters crowing and their crow having to do with what the weather will be for the rest of the duration of the day. You'll also find situations where animals were perceived to gather to themselves a heavier coat or heavier plumage based upon the winter weather. So people especially paid attention to the geese, whether or not their plumage was very thick. The sheep as well were thought to have this particular sensitivity. You're also going to find things like inverse proportions. For instance, if it's in the late fall or early winter, and you find that horses have frost on their backs in the early morning, the belief was that you would have fair weather the rest of the day. So even though there is ice or frost in this case, you'll see that it's believed to have a direct, or I should say inverse, proportion to what the weather will actually be. You'll also find different types of animals, not just in terms of farm animals, but also wild animals, such as the owl, which was believed to portend the weather. If the owl hoots from the tree, the idea is that it was going to be clear weather. And if it hoots from the pines out in the hills, that means that owl is starting to head for the hills and the weather was going to turn for the worst. These were things that folks observed in previous generations. Some of the old ones were that if a rooster crows before 9 at night, that portended that it was going to rain the following day. You'll also find examples of things that were commonly found in the natural world, such as woolly bear caterpillars, which folks believed that the back of the woolly bear caterpillar had a color arrangement that was associated with the weather. And many times you're going to find that folks would say that if the caterpillar had three areas on its back, they represented the 3 months of winter, and it was going to tell what the weather would be like, therefore. And often this tended to be January, February, and March. And so you would find that, for instance, this particular woolly bear caterpillar might suggest that we have heavy snow in January, a little bit lighter of the weather in February, it might clear, and then it would turn sour again in March. And this type of thing is, of course, determined by animal genetics, what this particular arrangement is. This is the most common arrangement of colors that you find on the woolly bear caterpillar. Rarely do you find the months divided up in different ways. Sometimes you'll find an all-black woolly bear caterpillar that was thought to portend a hard winter, but usually, year after year, it portends the same thing. And some folks have observed that this might actually be the case periodically, that the last month of the winter might have, again, this kind of return to bad weather. The trees were also thought to affect this as well. Folks believed that if there were a lot of acorns on the trees, this was just the same as if you found that sheep or geese were having heavier plumage or heavier wool. The idea would be that the trees were also going to be portending a heavy snowfall by having lots of nuts. And this was not just for oaks, but for many other different varieties of nut trees. Same thing with the husks on corn. It was believed, of course, that whether it was sweet corn or field corn, if the husks were thick, it meant that the corn was putting on its jacket in preparation for the bad weather. So a thick husk meant a hard winter. If, however, the husks were light and it almost revealed the kernels on the inside, this was believed that it would be a light winter. Ragweed. Hopefully you don't have too much of this in your garden these days, but ragweed was also thought to portend deep snow. And so as high as the ragweed was, so deep was the snow. Of course, if you're going to be weeding your garden, hopefully you won't find much of this, but this is something that would grow on the edge of farm lanes and pathways, and is something that was thought to, again, reflect the depth of the snow as being directly related to the height of the weed. Now, similarly, you're also going to find icicles pretending this. Some folks would say, as long as the icicles, so deep the snow. Folks would also say that icicles, especially between Christmas and New Year's, would portend a heavy nut crop the following year. Now, this is really interesting because you can see that not only would a heavy nut crop, such as the oaks that I described before, portend a hard winter, but so too would the long icicles from a hard winter portend a heavy nut crop. These things were thought to be related, and one would reveal the other. Now, many of these beliefs depend ultimately upon special days, just like I mentioned the icicles between Christmas and New Year's. So too are there special days throughout the year that were going to portend the weather, and many of these were rooted in beliefs surrounding the farmer's almanac and the agricultural year. So this is such an important thing because previous generations really relied on this, perhaps more so than any other book in the home, and this was such an important part of life. Today, folks remember the almanac traditions, they celebrate almanac traditions, but rarely are they employed with as close of a observation as they were in years past. And what you're going to typically find is that holidays were thought to influence the weather. The moon phases were thought to affect the weather because the moon would exert a force on the earth and, of course, on the upper atmosphere. And then there were other times of the month or days of the week that were thought to have a particular effect on the weather and good for weather observation, such as the last Friday of the month, which was believed to portend the weather for the next month. The fifth day of the month would portend the weather for the remaining of that particular month. And oftentimes you'll also find that the day of the month of the first snow was thought to portend the number of snowfalls for the rest of the season. I'll explain the logic behind that momentarily. What you typically find in the dialect are these types of old phrases. Everything I've described thus far was originally recorded in dialect. And so what you're essentially going to be finding is that these were things that were memorized, and sometimes they would rhyme or they would have a sing-song way of reciting them so people could very easily remember them. This one may not have as much of a sing-song sound, but you'll see the way in which language plays an important part in remembering these particular old sayings. So viel dog as es sin, vom erste Schnee bis vorliegt, so viel Schnee gibt's immer Winde. And so as many days as there are between the first snow and full moon indicates how many times it will snow in a winter. So if you were to look, for instance, at this particular calendar, this is for the month of August, of course, but just think about the idea that if the snow fell for the first time, say in December, on the 5th, you'd simply count down the rows of days on the calendar in order to be able to determine how many snowfalls there would be throughout the winter. This was thought to be somewhat foolproof, although I'm sure there was regional variation to the way that this was interpreted, because none of these phrases are true all the time. The mechanics of the moon governed this. Folks, of course, thought that the moon would exert a force on the earth and also a force on the upper atmosphere. During the time of the full moon, it was believed that the moon was going to be drawing a force away from the earth and also, therefore, also creating a change in the upper atmosphere. Same as during the new moon, it was believed to put a force towards the earth and therefore also was especially a time when you would observe things like changes in storms and things like that. This was something that folks were very sensitive to years ago, and there is some scientific basis for the fact that the moon affects things like tides, but this was, of course, thought to govern all aspects of life for previous generations. You'll also find that the saints' days were thought to be particularly helpful, and the liturgical calendar. So even though these are days that maybe not everybody is even aware of anymore, two particular days that were thought to affect the weather were July 2nd and August 15th, the day of the Visitation of the Virgin and Mary's Assumption, part of the Gospel narratives. This was the idea that Mary went to visit her sister on the Visitation of the Virgin, and then, of course, Mary was assumed into heaven, according to Roman Catholic tradition, on August 15th. The old phrases in the dialect come from this time when the predominant culture in all throughout Central Europe was Roman Catholic, and even though the Pennsylvania Dutch were largely Protestant, they still remembered these old ideas that when Mary goes over the mountain to visit her sister, the weather on that day would tell about the weather on the day of her return or the day of her assumption. So they would say, Vandi Maria, geht iva di barik for ira shvesta psuka. And various phrases would follow. And some people would say, of course, that if it's wet when she goes over, it'll be dry when she comes back. But there are many different ways of interpreting this, and there's no uniform way of doing it. Some people will say that if it's wet when she goes out, it'll be wet when she returns. Some people will say if it's dry, thus it'll also be dry. And others say it's inverse, that if it's dry on that day, it'll be wet on her return. And so the idea was that this was going to portend the the months in between in terms of its of the weather and then also the particular day. And there were many different ways that this has been recorded over the years. But many different liturgical days were thought to have an effect. Everything from Good Friday and Pentecost. If it rains on those days, then you'd have seven rainy Sundays. I put together this little graph here so you can see if it rains, snows, is cloudy on the following days, then the result would be the following aspects. So for instance, if there's ice on Shrove Tuesday, then you would have a tall flax crop. If it's cloudy on St. Jacob's Day, you would have deep winter snow. If it rains on Jan Hus Day, then you would have no nut crop. These types of things were commonly memorized and very, very common for earlier generations. Just like people would say, if the weather is fine on All Saints Day and All Souls Day, it would remain fine for 6 weeks. And if the weather is cold and raw, then winter is already here. They'd say it in the dialect, Van Zuf ha alle heil and unseil she is, bleibt noch sechs Woche she. Is es Wetter aber rau, dann ist der Winde do. People would also do little diagnostic things. They would fill 12 onions or 12 turnips with salt and hide them in a place in the home between Christmas and New Year's. Then on New Year's Day, they would check those onions and they would name each of those onions for the different months of the year before they would put them away. The idea was that the onions would oxidize and they would change color because of the salt, as onions do. The belief was then that the onions that would have most intense coloration, that would indicate changes in the weather for those particular months. This was a very old form of weather divination. Another thing folks used to do, typically in November, oftentimes immediately following Thanksgiving, they would take the breastbone from a goose, and a person would inspect the zones of the breastbone in order to portend the weather based on dots that would appear on the breastbone due to the fact that there would be fat left over from the goose fat would get into the bone and it would cause coloration from the inside out. And this was commonly done by a fellow by the name of Willoughby Troxell, who was from Laurie Station, Lehigh County, but he learned from one of the most celebrated Berks County goosebone prophets, who was from Reading, Pennsylvania. So this was all throughout the area. People used to publish the results of the goosebone prophets every year in the local papers, and this was thought to be as accurate, if not more, than meteorological predictions. And many different types of controversies also developed over it when the weatherman was not correct, but the goosebone prophet was. Of course, the most popular of these is Groundhog Day, and I want to wrap up by describing just a couple aspects about the way Groundhog Day developed in this area. So Groundhog Day happens to also be the day of Candlemas, which according to the Christian calendar was the day in which the Virgin Mary left confinement. In the old Jewish tradition, a woman would be confined for 40 days following giving birth. So this was a time when she left confinement to take Christ to the temple. And of course, this is part of the way in which folks would think about that particular feast day. On February 2nd, it was believed that you were supposed to put aside those things that were winter activities and start thinking about spring and take stock of all those different aspects of what it is that you have on the farm. The old phrase was Lichtmess, Spinne vergess, Hava Stroh and Hava Fress. It means on Candlemas, forget spinning and assess your fodder and your straw. This was a day when you had to take stock of what it was that you were doing, put aside the winter activities, and begin the process of preparing for the coming growing season. Now, Groundhog Day, of course, is on exactly the same day. Just as Mary came out of confinement, so too does the groundhog come out of its lair. This is an ancient metaphor for the way in which folks would think about hibernating animals as essentially portending the weather because they would leave the land of the living, descend into the underworld, and come back with some form of hidden knowledge. Believe it or not, this was something that at one point in time was all across Europe. Ancient cultures observed the bear, and the Celts did as well, but you're also going to find that some of the early German cultures also took a look at the badger. There were many, very many different hibernating animals that were observed, but the groundhog is what we have here in Pennsylvania. It was Dachsdog in Germany prior to emigration. When people got here, they observed the groundhog. Very first time that we know of this as having been documented was in the 1830s in Berks County, Pennsylvania. The tradition is from the 18th century emigrations, of course, but the first time it was ever written down was by an Episcopalian who lived in southern Berks County who observed his German-speaking neighbors who said, something strange is going on here. They go out and they look at this groundhog and they claim it has something to do with the weather. So this is part of our observations this year. And of course, there's all kinds of cultural festivals all throughout the area honoring the groundhogs. And the groundhog lodges especially are very active this time of year. And This is, of course, one of the ways that Pennsylvania Dutch people help to celebrate local culture, celebrate these old traditions of weather prognostication. And I want to wrap up today by wishing you a good Groundhog Day and a good season. Haben gute Grundsaudag. And hopefully, even if you don't believe the groundhog, maybe you can take a look at some of these other weather prognostication techniques I've told you today to take a look at what's coming for the rest of the year. If you're interested in attending any number of the Groundhog events that are going to be happening in this early part of spring and throughout most of the spring in many communities across Pennsylvania, you can find out about when these lodges are taking place, who to contact, and how to get tickets. I will remind everybody, these are always ticketed events, so you do have to contact folks in advance in order to be able to attend them. But if you're interested in finding out more about this, you can go to www.groundhoglodge.org to find out about the dates and the ways that you can attend.
Now ist die Zeit von unser Sprichwort von Monat, our proverb of the month. Was ist es so gut, als die Leute es Wetter nicht machen können? How good it is that people cannot make the weather. This simple proverb reminds us that there are some things that are better left beyond our control. We concern ourselves enough with the details of our busy lives and various preoccupations, but the weather is one powerful and humbling reminder that we are not as firmly in control of our circumstances as we might imagine. Vel lieve Leit, zel is alles, was mir henheit, für de Pennsylvanische Deutsch stun, groß dank für watche, und me sehne alle eich nächst Monat, do on BCTV. Haben gute Hanning, gebackt an de Grundsau, und mach's gut.
Maria, a fresh air, God.